the bad years, the crisis years, the Dow dropped by about 50%. And since then, it's, you know, and people panicked and got out, of course, even in the mutual fund business, and particularly in the ETF business, a lot of net liquidations at the lows. And now we're back. I think the gain from that level is maybe 200%. So it shows you that when you act on the emotions of the marketplace, you're making a big mistake. You know, I stay and always have said, stay the course. Don't let these changes in the market, even a big one, that was a 50% decline, don't let that change your mind. And never, never, never be in or out of the market. Always be in at a certain level. You know, you may want to be 50% in stocks like I am. You may want to be 75% or 25%. That's probably a decent range. But never be out and think you can get back in, because your emotions will defeat you totally.
One of my favorite Jack Bogle lines is when somebody says, buy and hold is dead. Or when they ask you, is buy and hold dead? What do you say? You always say, depends on what you buy, right?
Well, buy and hold for a stock is one thing. Buy and hold the U.S. stock market is quite a different one. You know, what do we have going for us in the U.S. stock market? I'll leave aside how hard it is to pick the winners, how few people really ever heard of Amazon 25 years ago, to say nothing of Google, maybe a little more than that, maybe 30 years ago. So if you hold the stock market, you will, not to be corny, Bill, but you will grow with America. The correlation between the long-term growth of America's gross domestic product, so-called GDP, and the stock market is, you know, something like 95. But the annual correlation of those two things is probably 20. So, you know, you're making a good long-term bet, but short-term betting is just not a good way to go.
Jack, I want to ask you about what could possibly cause the next crisis, and I want to bring your attention to a note that was released by J.P. Morgan last week called the Great Liquidity Crisis, and in it, they say that it's a massive move in funds to passive investing that could help spark this next liquidity crisis and, in turn, the next financial crisis, that there's a large pool of buyers out there that are mechanical buyers, and electronic trading desks at a time when volatility spikes tend to step away from the market, reducing liquidity even further. Do you think that the market structure as it is right now could contribute to this sort of liquidity crunch the next time we have a volatility spike?
Well, to be honest, there are areas of the exchange-traded fund market in particular that could be very much subject to the same kind of pressures, liquidity pressures that you're talking about. When you get into the main part of the index fund market, the S&P 500, the total U.S. stock market, it's not really conceivable because they are the market. And if there's a panic there, there will be a panic everywhere by definition. So I think to call out panic is, more than anything else, I believe, an attempt to say, be careful of those index funds. And what they really mean by that is, use our active management, we'll do better, even though they know deep down they will not.
So I'm sorry, Jack, just to clarify, when you say certain exchange-traded funds, what kinds of ETFs are you talking about? Because most people are invested in the S&P 500 through general index ETFs. So which ETFs would you be concerned about?
High yield is always a problem. They've had liquidity problems before, and they may well have them again. And what's interesting about high yields, and it's a statement about the market's tolerance for risk, is the yields on high yield bonds, or much of the spread between the yields on high yields and corporate bonds, are much narrower than they've been before. In other words, people don't think they're that risky, and they could easily get a very unpleasant surprise.
Jack, we've been reflecting on 10 years since the financial crisis for much of this week and asking most of our guests if we're safer now. Do you think that the crisis that we saw 10 years ago could be avoided today because of the tools that we've used previously and the safeguards we've put in place? Or are there blind spots that we just haven't seen yet?
Well, there are always blind spots. Or as I've said, the market, the fog of the stock market. Nobody really knows what's going on. That particular crisis may or may not come again, a liquidity crisis in the financial system, although it could, because debt right now has gone way back up. And things like student loan are probably double what they were then. Housing, usually home equity loans, are back up to where they were then. Real estate prices, home real estate prices, have come back to the exact level they were way back in in 2009 before the, I'm sorry, 2006 before the crisis started. So it can always happen again. But what we really know is, or don't know is, you know, there are risks that we know, but there are risks that we don't know even exist. And that's the problem. Every crisis is different.
Right.
Every bear market is different. And there are a lot of signs of exposure in the market, but I think nothing right now that would cause me to get out of a long-term investment program, and certainly nothing that would stop me from continuing to put away my $100 or $200 or $500 every month in my 401k or my IRA thrift plan.